Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mok Lai. The song I just played is Rose Rose, I Love You, or rather, Mei Kui Mei Kui Wo Ai Ni, the original Mandarin version. From 1946, I think, I believe. This is Al's favorite song from his time in Singapore. So he wanted this to be a surprise. Due to some hiccup, there was not much surprise, but this was the same piece that was played in 2010 on 938 Live. Once upon a time, yeah, a few years ago. The same copy that I used. My name is Mok Lai Ying, and I'm supposed to be the organizer with Koo Yi Hoon. She's standing over there. She's the mastermind behind the whole activity. I got to know Al from 2008. My association with this 81 Squadron, this is the Royal Air Force 81 Squadron, Photo Reconnaissance Squadron. They were here from 1946 until 1970. Their mission was to take photographs, originally for mapping purposes, and subsequently due to the advent of the Malayan emergency, they were assigned the additional task of photographic intelligence. I think Al will tell more about this aspect. But I was doing my interest is in the history of surveys and mapping in Singapore. So by 2006, I come to the phase to research more on the air photography aspects of Singapore's mapping history. So one of the maps that I come upon is the 81 Squadron's photography. The map was published in 1950. And on it, it was said that the photographs were taken by 81 Squadron, Royal Air Force. That's it, that's one line. So I began to search the web, and I found a link, an email link to an individual who had ties with 81 Squadron. And eventually, through this loop, I was connected with members of the 81 Squadron. Apparently, the squadron had only set up its website in 2006. So I was fortunate that I started my research at that time. So then after that, after a few email correspondences, the threat sort of stopped. You know, use the word threat, so it stopped. Then in 2008, 2 years later, one fine day out of the blue, I received an email from the same squadron saying that Mr. Al Taylor is going to visit Singapore very soon and he can tell you anything you wanted to know about the squadron. So soon enough, when he came, I had to exchange information with him because I never met him before and he hasn't seen me before. And at the time, I was not familiar with all this kind of selfie and anything, no photograph. So I would use hype and all this description, traditional way of describing a person. So when we first met, yeah, he beat my expectation. He told me he's about 6 feet four or something, so I told him about I'm 5 foot four or something like that. Yeah, so I have to look up, you see. So looking for him, I go look down, I look up, the horizon is different. So I found him immediately, because the horizon was like that when I saw him at the hotel lobby. Yeah, that was how we met. And sort of we clicked. The thing is, I think it was very well the meeting in 2008. And that's how the story evolved. Then they have been here with the wife, Yvonne, since 2008, almost every year, except for 2011. So this is their sixth time visiting Singapore. And Al left, Al was here in 1955, and he left in 58. And for 50 years, he did not return to Singapore. I think he will tell you the reason why. And he struggled to come back again and see Singapore after so many years. It's almost like the story of Rick Van Winkle or something. Yeah, I think see my whole place has changed and so on. I think he's here this. All these years, and after this year, this particular year, he said that this will be probably his last time visiting Singapore. So when we heard about it, I thought, because all these years he's been sharing with me all the stories about life in the 50s and what he has learned in Singapore, life lessons learned in Singapore. Not just the technical aspects. The first 2 years, we spent a lot of time talking about technical aspects. Various aircraft, the engines, even the wire that ties the boat to a nut and something like that has in it, because you don't tie it too many times, it's so on and so forth, the tension, all these things very important. We went to the RAF Museum in Bali, but we spent many hours there describing all the parts of an engine. So these are the things. And so eventually I thought, maybe this is the last time, so perhaps I should let other Singaporeans have the opportunity to listen to what we had learned in Singapore and to share with everyone some of these stories. So without further ado, yes, Mr. Al Kelly.
Can you hear me?
No.
Dim the lights.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes, you can. All right, you're going to stand here on that one with the voice. All right, don't worry. We'll swing it. Okay, well, thank you very much for all of you turning up today. First of all, I'd like to extend my thanks to the Esplanade and the National Library for setting up this, or allowing this to happen today, particularly the National Library, and to Koo Lee Hoon and Mok Lai Ying for their hard work in bringing it to this stage. There's a few other people that have also made this possible. There's Afida from the library, and Chris Tang, and there's also Eric from the archives as well. Everybody's been most helpful. And I would like to introduce also Madam Tan Li San, and also Mr. Chen Wen Yu and his wife Elaine, Pamela Ho, and also Philip, Honey, Eddie and Honey are both ex-81 squadron as well. I don't know the gentleman next to them. I think I've seen this bird on the end a few times. okay, now, what I'm going to try and do now is to compress 3 years down into about an hour. And I'm going to try and allow some time for questions afterwards. And you may be bored to tears by that time, I don't know. But anyhow, if we are shoveled out of this room, and we can probably muster upstairs on the ninth floor by the Bucket Brown mosaic that's up there. Magnificent piece of work by Mok Lai Ying and his skills and so forth, and a hell of a lot of volunteers. Now, the volunteers are the unsung heroes always. Okay, now, I was born in 1936, so that makes me a Leo, because I was born in, sorry, the 19th of August 1936. That makes me a Leo in the Western world, and a rat, I believe, in the Chinese world. So, yes, I'll put my hand up to being a rat. Okay, so, up until about 1939, I can't remember very much because I was born at a very early age. But 1939, the war broke out in the UK, and not too much happened in that first year. Around about 1940, 41, things started to soup up a little bit, and with the Battle of Britain and so forth. I do remember the Battle of Britain and the dogfights and so forth. From that point on, from 39 to 45, the things that you remember was the Blitz, rationing, the Blitz and rationing, and the Blitz and rationing. Because we see it, we bomb down here every day. And I know that Singapore went through the same sort of problem, but I understand it was only for a couple of months, basically. Now I say only a couple of months, it doesn't make any difference, it's still damn hard to put up with. So, roaming around the UK, rationing was the biggest thing because food was so scarce, as it was in Singapore during the period of the occupation. 1951, I started work in a solicitor's office, actually. I was drawn out of school at 14 and a half, not because I was too disruptive, but purely and simply the fact my mother couldn't stand authority and she couldn't work with people for too long, so we moved around a fair bit. Plus the fact Jerry was chasing us around a little bit. 1954, I was called up for National Service, and in the UK, at that time, every medically fit male had to comply to 2 years of National Service. Now, if you were in university where you could get a deferment, or if you had a restricted job, you could get a deferment. But some people prefer to get it over with and then go to university, etc. So I got called up for National Service. I was approved as A1 fit. So they said, right, go away. We'll send you another letter in about a fortnight's time and we'll tell you where you're going. I said, what do you mean where we're going? They said, well, whether you're going to the Army, the Navy or the Air Force. And I said, sorry, I'm not going in the Army and I'm not going in the Navy. I'm going in the Air Force and I'm going to work on aircraft engines. Don't ask me why, that's what I wanted to do. So we had a few discussions about this, and in the end they said, look, if you really want what you want to do, because in your National Service, you'll go where you're put. So they said, well, if you really want to do that, go down the end of this corridor, sit there. I sat there for a while. I was interviewed by three officers, and they finally decided, okay, yeah, he's good enough, we'll have him in. So I was immediately called up then for regular service. I had to sign on. And I ended up doing my square bash near a place near Manchester called RAF Padgate. From there I went down to South Wales to RAF Seletar, did my engine training. And on a couple of days before the end, they knew who was going to pass and who wasn't. The next thing was it came up on the unit orders, postings. Everybody's rushing to get at the postings. Finally I got there. My name started with T, I'm way down the end of the list, etc. Hong Kong. Wow, where's that? Most blokes will say, I don't know, but I'll swap with you. I'm going to RAF Ruff with her, I'm going here, I'm going to say, no, I'll stick with it. That's my fate, I'll stick with it. 4.5 days later, after we departed from Blackbush on a civilian charter flight, a trooping flight, we ended up in Singapore. Incidentally, on the way, we did 3 stops in India, which I think was also included Pakistan in those days. But anyhow, it seemed pretty strange that we did these 3 stops, 2 of which were overnight. We finally got to Singapore, and at each stop, you had to deplane, get off the plane so that they could refuel for safety reasons. So we got to the stage where we got off the plane at Singapore, and I'm thinking, wow, isn't this gorgeous, it's warm, lovely. And clean, and look at those palm trees, and look at everything else, etc. Next thing I knew was, there's a corporal out there saying, right, all those people for Singapore, over here. When I call these other names out, over there, they call my name out. And I said, you've called my name out. So I said, yeah, is this Hong Kong? I said, no, it's Singapore. Oh, well, I'm going to Hong Kong. No, you're not, you're staying here. All right. So, next thing I knew was, I'm shoveled off onto a Gary, over to RAF Seletar, and then we're taken down to the clothing store, and everybody else is carrying their bags and everything else, and I said, well, where's mine? I said, well, didn't you bring it with you? I said, I got off the plane because you were refueling. I'm going to Hong Kong. They said, no, you're staying here. I said, well, where's my baggage then? They said, well, didn't you take it? This went on backwards and forwards, etc. It's like a ping pong game, you see. So, in the end, they said, well, look, get a bed and we'll sort things out. Yeah, okay, well, the ways of Air Force sorting things out is, you'll sort it out, won't you, tomorrow. Next morning, breakfast, down to the clothing store so that we can get our clothing. I hadn't got anything else other than what I had travelled in, nothing. So when I got all my kit, my KD uniform, there was a few things missing, like badges and my hat and my shoes, and so forth. So at the end of the day, I'm ready to go over to the West Camp, to 81 Squadron, where I was posted to, and I knew nothing about 81 Squadron. When I got over there, I looked at this rabble. That's all he could call them. They were a rabble. They were walking around in just a pair of shorts and a pair of plimsolls. That was it. Some of them had a bit of rag around their neck, some of them had this squash hat on their head. But I'd actually been given in the kit, which was a new issue, and they'd been given it to trial, and they'd painted Mickey Mouse on it, and 81 Squadron badges and so forth. And anyhow, I got on this squadron, saw the chiefie, who's the man in charge, and he said to me, okay, we know you're here now, go to the admin's office and see the corporal in there, and we'll see you back here. Tomorrow morning, when you've finished your work, just dump your stuff in the billet, find yourself a pit, a bed space, and then come back over here. Well, then I met these folks, and they were like Amazons. They weren't really, some of them were just so high, some of them, but they just seemed, they had this aura about them. They were all sort of tanned, and they looked so experienced, and then they swaggered. They literally swaggered. And I thought to myself, this looks pretty good. And over the months and then over the years, I gradually became an 81, an 81er. We were bulletproof. We didn't care about the shiny bums on the other side of the camp. That was the admin side. What I fast found out was that 81 Squadron was operational. It was on active service. At that time, we were not only doing the mapping, but in 1948, they had taken over the intelligence as well. So it was photographic intelligence. And the photographic intelligence was brought about when Chin Peng decided to spit the dummy and move into the jungle and fight against the British once again. Now, before anybody could move into the jungle,
at the Army, or even before the Navy could bombard, or before the Air Force could go in and fire their rockets or things, that I couldn't understand because I was on engines, etc. But anyhow, before they could do that, 81 Squadron had to go in and do a photographic reconnaissance run. Now, I can explain more about the detail of photographic intelligence if afterwards, if we want to meet up on the ninth floor where the mosaic is, because there's a lot there that I can explain much easier than standing here waffling on about it, etc. And also, Lai will be up there as well, so you'll get a heap of information about that side of it and the wonderful work that he did to get that mosaic up and running. So 81 Squadron at the time were flying Spitfires and Mosquitoes. Now, I don't know if anybody knows about the difference between the Spitfire and the Mosquito, but the Spitfire is the most beautiful aircraft ever built. She's the sexiest lady there is. Not only that, but she had a Rolls-Royce engine up front, and I was trained on Rolls-Royce engines, but these were pistons. Now, the Spitfires that we had used the Griffin, which was the upgraded Merlin, but the Mosquitoes were a twin engine, another beautiful aircraft, and you probably saw one on the front of the information about this little venue this afternoon. So the two, the Merlins, when they were first designed, and this is the sexy part, ladies, you really will get excited about this. Anybody drive a 2 litre car or anything around about that size? Anybody got a 2 litre car? Yep, okay. That's about 20 horsepower. When the Merlin was designed and put in service, it rated at 900 horsepower. Don't need to explain any more to you. That is sexy, isn't it? But by the time they finished redeveloping it, etc., and bringing it on, it actually produced somewhere around about 1,700 horsepower. And when they then added a double supercharger onto the back of it and made it into the Griffin, that brought it up to 2,000 horsepower. And that could take the Spitfire to somewhere around about 49,000 feet. Now, when we flew from Brisbane to here, we were flying at around about 32,000 feet. But that got the Spitfire, that particular model, which were PR-19s, out of trouble quite a few times. And I'll talk more about that in a moment. The Mosquito didn't get up quite so high because they had the Merlins, but with the Griffins, certainly aided towards the performance of the Spitfire. So there you've got two of the most beautiful aircraft in the world, in my book anyhow. It was an adrenaline rush all the time. We were operational. Our photography work was done normally between the hours of 7 in the morning and 1 o'clock, and after that it was a waste of time. And I think if you want to talk about the real details about the quality of photography, you need to talk to Lai about that, because he will explain to you better about the quality of the photographs by 81 Squadron, and you cannot obtain that quality today from satellite photographs. Not only that, but the size of the photographs, quality, everything else put forward, Singapore, you have a big heritage. You have a big, big heritage from what was left to you by 81 Squadron. And Lai can explain that to you far better than what I can. On the squadron, we had the normal crew, which would go in at 8 o'clock in the morning and finish, sorry, they would go in at 7 o'clock in the morning and finish at 1. And we also had a duty crew. The duty crew would start at 5 in the morning, and we would finish about 8 o'clock, so it was an hour overlap in the morning to get aircraft off the ground. Because that's what the Air Force is for, aircraft in the sky. Then we would go to lunch at about 11:30. 12 o'clock we'd go back to the squadron, another hour overlap. And then the main crew could then hand over if there was any snags or problems, as we call them. If an aircraft was US or something like that we worked on, we'd call it a snag. And you were then told, now, you might, on duty crew, be finished by 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Other than that, you might finish at 11 o'clock that night, depending on what the problems were. If you had to work on to get that aircraft because it was needed for the next morning, and even if you had an engine change, you just got stuck into it and did it. You would get supper supplied probably, and you might be working on for the early hours of the morning. So with this mateship that I was developing there and being bulletproof, there was a lot of camaraderie, a lot of niggling, not niggling, but you know, we used to get on to one another something terrible. We were wicked at times because our best mates were our airframe folks. And airframes, we called them lepers. Somebody said to me, why do you call the blokes your lepers? Why do you call them lepers? I said, I don't know, we just call them lepers. Photographers were called photogs. Wireless blokes, I seem to remember, were called airheads. There had to be a variety of names for all the different people. But at the end of the day, there was something that drew us all together. And if you were out on the pan working away, and I used to love being out in the pan because I just had a pair of shorts on. And in those days, I used to be styled on a chopstick. Now it's a bundle of chopsticks. Oh, that's all I had. I loved the sun. Never wore anything apart from a pair of shorts, a bit of decency, and a pair of crimp soles, because we couldn't get on the aircraft with leather sole shoes because of scratching them or causing a spark. But whenever you needed help from these people you've been using, calling all these names, for instance, our photogs or photographers, another name we had for them were termites. You know why they called them termites? Because they worked in the dark room and like termites, they didn't like coming out in the sun. So we called them termites. And that's a term that we affectionately use nowadays. And if I had any of my, anyone's got an associate members over here now, you would hear this going backwards and forwards, etc. all the time. All right, so if we needed any help, there was a call sign that we had, or a call, a yell. You just yell us out. We yell out, 2-6 on 971. That was the number of the aircraft. So the 2-6, I believe, came from section 2, paragraph 6 of the Aircraft Movements AP, which was an aircraft publication. Now the Air Force has a publication for everything. It even has a number for a tree. Can you believe that? There's nothing that doesn't get a number in the Air Force. And I'll show you what I can even remember it to this day. I'll tell you what it was. This is for a tree, right? This is the Air Force number. Can you see that? Everybody see it up the back?
Yes.
Somebody like to read it out?
4K9PAPA.
4K9P. P. Yeah.
K9P.
Did you get it?
Yeah.
But Tommy.
What does a dog drop against a tree? Okay. Up on orders came one day. My name. 4 o'clock the next morning. Be ready. Be breakfast. Be ready to get up the gallery. Where are we going? I've got no idea at all. We didn't know where we were going. There was about 16 of us. So we hopped on the gharry, ended up at the armory, drew a rifle. 10 rounds. 10 rounds? Why 10 rounds? We normally only get 5 rounds when we go on guard duty. This must be serious. So we ended up down on the Johor Straits, down on the ramp, where the flying boats used to be pulled up to the ramp if they were had to be serviced on a major service, etc. And then these two little dugout sort of canoes arrived, and they had this long pole behind them, with a propeller on the end of it, and this little petrol engine. And we're all done up in our KDs and boots, and we've got this ungainly rifle and nothing else. So we chucked across the Straits of Johor and ended up somewhere in Johor, and we ended up finally at a place called Tarok Sengat, which was a rubber plantation. Our CO's brother apparently was the manager of this rubber plantation, and he left about 3 months after I joined 81 Squadron. So before he left, he wanted to go up and see his brother. So how he worked it, I don't know. It was probably totally illegal, but we ended up getting up there. Okay, there was things like a 9X site at Seletar, that was on the east side of Salina, which is now up against sort of that development that goes on in Bungle, in that area there, sort of thing, you know. And that was the Far East Air Force ammunition and bomb dump. And we used to have to guard that sometimes. On top of the operational duties that we were doing, sometimes we had, the camp CO would insist that 81 Squadron had to do their fair share of guards. And that was a frightening place, because it did get raided a few times by some of the fellows that wanted to pinch bombs. I don't know what they wanted to do with them, but still. So apart from that, we had a whole host of other guards as well, including lighter guards, which was down in Singapore Harbour. And when the ships used to come in, and of course Singapore Harbour was further this way at that time, and when the ships used to come in, the bombs and ammunition used to be offloaded on the ships onto these lighters, and then the lighters used to be moored there overnight and then towed round and unloaded up at Salita, and then it would be taken onto 9X site. Now, if you want to learn more about the lighters and what it was like being on the lighter, and actually the duties you had to perform, and how dangerous it was in a sense, because Ted Wilkins, one of my very dear mates, wrote this book, and that is now digitalised into an e-book. It's also a copy within the library, and I understand, because I signed the paperwork the other day, that is, will now, very shortly, be coming online. Is that right? Good, that's it. So, all Singaporeans will be able to access this, but also, that is an e-book now. And Lying was able to arrange with a local publisher for this to be converted into an e-book. So, later on, Lying will put up on the screen if you wanted to access that. But that is an account from my dear mate Ted of his time that he spent over here. The detail in it is amazing, and I said to him, how is it you could remember all of those names for all those ceremonies and everything else and all the places? It's quite simple, he said. I used to ride home for my mother. Now I hear that, huh? It's out there, yeah. Good old mum, eh? And when I got back, she told me about it. Unfortunately, she's passed on now, so I inherited it. And his granddaughter said to him one day, Pop, what did you do during the war? And he said, I wasn't old enough to be in the war. So what happened? He said, well, you know, you got a medal and you got this, and he said, well, and he explained it. So he decided to write a book for his granddaughter. So there's the book. Brilliant book. It's not the usual type of book that you would expect, but it's loaded with Singapore's history, its heritage. It's a great read. So I urge you to either get onto the library and read it, or get onto the e-books if you can do that, if you've got that facility. I'm only just getting into that world now, I'm totally confused by it. But we've also got another book here, which has just become available, and I just managed to bring over four copies with me. I managed to get it from the UK. And this is an update, and I noticed that I was surprised I couldn't remember the memorabilia that I'd given back to Singapore a few years ago, and that in there was a scrapbook. And it was by the same gentleman, who one of my mates, he came after me actually on Squadron, but it's known as the 81 Squadron Scrapbook, and there is a host of stories in there. A lot of it about Singapore, and it's mainly about 81 Squadron, but there is going to be a copy available here in Singapore, and we are hoping, we're having discussions by myself, to be able to hopefully get this made into an e-book as well. But that is, again, got a host of information about Singapore. And, of course, the history of 81 Squadron prior to it coming to... It had a 24-year history here in Singapore before it was disbanded in 1970. Yes, we had a little Malay atap hut, which was a sort of kopitiam, just next to the hangar. And our NAFI, which was the Navy, Army and Air Forces Institute, van used to come around, and their food was worse than work. So anyhow, we used to nip over this little kopitiam, and I always called it Kopiapui. when we came over here on one occasion, we went down to the station, and they were serving, sure enough, he said, and I asked for a copy of it, and the bloke looked at me. What are you talking about? And I've only realised just recently probably that what he meant was copy of IPO. Or IPO. But the way that I overheard them saying it in the little cafe was, it was copy of IPO. So for all these years, I thought it was called copy up. And that was all we should be, copy up, boy, and they come along. And you could stand your spoon up in it, and just leave the spoon in it and stand up, because it had that much condensed milk in it. And not only that, but they then put four or five shovelfuls of sugar in it. I tell you what, you didn't need to worry about your energy levels for about a week afterwards. Okay, and then we used to have these little bits of like French bread with Malay butter, which always tasted to me like it was rancid, but I liked it, and then Malay jam. And we used to have this, about this long mug of their coffee, and this, and we'd be walking across the road, and all the rest of the employees over at East Camp, West Camp rather, were all done up, smart, pressed uniforms, and I said, we're swaggering across there because we're 81 Squadron, we're operational, we just took no notice of the rest of the world. Our CO had to put up with hell. Because there was always somebody complaining about 81 Squadron. Whether we'd done it or not, if somebody had done something really bad, 81 Squadron, blame them. Send the police over there, right? So we had to put up with a hell of a lot. Our CO did, but he was wonderful. And he knew that if we did the job, which we did, it was worth it. And I don't know to this day of him ever charging anybody. And one day it came up with orders that there was an exchange posting with another engine mechanic, exactly the same as me, turbines, engine mechanic, SAC, up in Sekong, just north of Kai Tak, on Venom Squadron. I thought, oh, fine, put my application in that morning. I'm working out in the pan. Our admin corporal comes around and says, Al, get upstairs. Why? CO wants to see you. Oh, I haven't finished it. Get upstairs. Right. I've got to go and get my jacket then. It's back in the billet. Get upstairs. So I said, oh, problem. Get upstairs. I went upstairs. Stood in the doorway there, stood for attention sort of thing. And she said, oh, come in. Yep. Now, I understand you put in for this exchange posting for Kai Tak. That's correct, sir. I asked you why. Oh. Just to further my career a little bit, probably, sir, you know. I hadn't thought about it too much, but anyhow. And he said to me, well, do you know where it is? No, sir, I've got no idea at all. So he showed me a map which would have been about three times the size of this screen here on the wall. It took up the whole of the wall. And he said, see this little dot here? Yeah. That's Singapore. See this little dot up here? Yes. That's Hong Kong. See that little tiny dot up there? Well, it's only about that much. Further, so it's not very far, you know. Yeah, that's Sekong. See that red line? Yeah, that's the communist border. Still want to go? Young and silly, and I said, oh yeah, yeah, I don't mind, sir. So we ripped it up, and said, denied, threw it away. About 4 months later, I was on a detachment to Kai Tak. Over Christmas, 56, 57. 3 weeks time, we worked damn hard. And we played damn hard. When we got up there, we were in KDs. They were in their winter. We should have had blues on. That was our UK uniform. Mine was packed down in Seletar and left there. So we had to go out and buy civilian clothing, and we worked out in the pan in civilian clothing. When we got back, we got a compliment paid to us by the CO, because the work we'd done in 3 weeks had been quoted to take 6 months by a private contractor. And it cost him an absolute mozza for that to be done. And he said, the quality of the work that you people have done, we said, well, all we did was get the aircraft flying. There was only three of us, there should have been seven, but there was only three that could be set up there. Now another little bit of history for you. Singapore has the benefit of having flown the last operational Spitfire operational duties in the Royal Air Force throughout the world. That's PS-888. That was the 1st of April 1954. They also had the benefit of the last Mosquito being flown in Singapore. That was on the 15th of December 1955. Two Mosquitoes were sent on the detachment because they used to roam all over the Far East, very often in a lot of deniable missions, by the way. They're the ones where, if it was possible, we wouldn't mind having some information from over there. But if you get caught, we know nothing about it. Today it's known as deniables, and a lot of that was done. And if you want more information on that, there's a website that I'll put up on the board for you. I don't have the full website details, but I'll just write this down for you. And if you write there, if you enter, if you Google SPIC files over China, you will come up with a flight Lieutenant Ted Powers. You don't have to bother about that now, because when this is finished you can come up and take those details down. But the site is, if you just Google Spitfires over China and look for Flight Lieutenant Ted Powers, that'll tell you about some of the deniable missions and some of the dead stick landings that he had to do at Pai Tak. Dead stick landing, anybody know what that is? No engine. Engine has stopped. If it does that on the side of the road, so what? You get out, you get yourself safe. If you do that halfway between Hong Kong and Hainan Island, good luck. In those days, there was nobody around. But if you got caught, we know nothing about it. Two Mosquitoes were sent up to Colombo. What for? They didn't know. They got up there and were met by a film crew. What are these? Mosquitoes. Oh, lovely. Where's the guns? We don't have guns, we have cameras. Well, we need guns. This is about a Mosquito fighter squadron. We don't have guns, we have cameras. So, one of my dear mates, Wilbur Wright, Brian Wright his name was, but because his name was Wright, he was nicknamed Wilbur. He and one of his mates that night got together, and somehow between them, they made up a gun pack. Stuck it on the transparent nose. They blanked out the nose, etc., of the Mosquito, and they stuck these guns on. So if you ever see the film Purple Plane, with Gregory Peck as the lead actor, you won't recognise him, but there's two blokes in there from the squadron as well that played bit parts in it. But you'll see the two PR-34 photographic reconnaissance Mosquitoes with broomsticks sticking out the front. Okay, now, what I want to do now, that's a little bit about the service, and I'm dragging a bit behind time, so I'm going to move on a bit. One thing I noticed when we first came, I'm going to go into the culture and the cultural shock of coming to Singapore. First thing I noticed was, it's warm, it's sunny, it's bright, and there's an abundance of food. 9 short years before, you'd been under the control of the Japanese, and food was pretty scarce. But suddenly, when I went downtown for the first... Oh, sorry. I'll just go back a little bit. I mentioned to you that my kit had all gone off up to Hong Kong. I had nothing. I was here, I was in Seletar. I got nothing. None of my Air Force kit or equipment or anything. It took me about 8 weeks for that to come back down because there was no computers in those days, so everything had to go flying up there. Then they had to look around and say, well, what's this for here? Oh, this is, oh, yeah, well, okay. And finally it arrived back and I got it, so I got my kit then. So when I went up for a pay parade, I didn't get any pay for about 8 weeks because nobody had any records of me. But they had me recorded as being arrived, but they didn't have my paperwork, so I got no money. So I had to borrow money. So the first pay packet I got wasn't my full amount, but it was a pretty good amount. I managed to pay back the amounts I borrowed, etc. So the first time I went downtown, or came downtown, was about 8 weeks later. And the fellow said, you can't get out of town tonight. I said, yeah, what are we going to do? He said, oh, we're going down to the mill. So they said, well, we can go to this one or that one, we can eat Asian food or we can do this. But we'll go to this place because it does a European type food. Oh, all right, fair enough. So we got down there. What are you going to have? I said, I don't know. What are you ordering? Oh, we're having mixed grill. Well, I ordered mixed grill. No way in the world could I've never seen that much meat. Yet the plate was just piled up. Pork chop, lamb chop, sausages, liver, kidney, you name it, and it was topped with two eggs. I had a job to even look at it, never mind eat it. Footwear, made to measure. We used to get a pair of football boots made by the little shoemaker on West Camp, just over the back of G Block. And there was a little block there, and there was the bathhouse in there. There was the shoemaker, there was the hairdresser, or the barber, and a couple of others. And I'd have, each season, we would have a pair of football boots made, because they only lasted the one season. And then you'd have shoes made, and they fitted like a glove. When I came here, everybody walked around in flip-flops or chappies. Incidentally, flip-flops are called thongs in Australia, or Asian safety boots. That's not done mentioned in a disparaging way in any way, but I did have a problem with a contractor on one occasion when he insisted coming on site. I said, mate, you're not wearing them. Public liability, can't allow it. He said, mate, they're double bungers, which meant they had two plugs for the front thong. And he said, mate, they're double bungers, he said. I said, I don't care, you're not coming on site with that. Well, he eventually did, because he was the tradesman I wanted. And I said, mate, you're not going to get any claim out of us, bear that in mind, you're on your own. He said, yep, that's fine. But I wanted him because he did the job the way I wanted it done. And that was, he made a perfect job of it. Okay, now we come to another little stage in my career. And for this, I need a little bit of help. And I'm going to ask, please. Because I'm going to ask you a favour, please. Can you do that? I said, good. Can you also do that? And with his hand, he said, good. Well, you now, I'm going to get dressed now because I came across a bloke. Well, you got fed up with it, did you? Okay. You don't get paid, you know, you're only doing half the job. Right? I got in touch with a bloke called Kewa. That's all I knew him by. That was his name. He had this little shop in Jalung Kayu. And I learned a hell of a lot from this bloke. I learned a lot on how to anaesthetise people. In sales. Because when I went into him, I used to have my shorts made because it was cheaper for me to get the shorts made and pay him than have them from my Air Force allowance, because they were Air Force kit and they didn't look too good. Plus they were dearer that way than carry while making them for me. And he used to make my shark skin shirts and all the rest of it. And I went in there on one occasion to get a suit made. Yeah, can you do that again, please? Because when I got in there, I said to him, he said, ah, hello, John, because everybody was John. We were John, they were John. Right? And he said, ah, John. What do you want? I said, I want a suit, mate. Ah, good. Righto. So, yeah, well, he went on like this, you see, and he's going, all this business. And he said, yeah, righto. And then he's taking other measurements. Well, I won't go through all the measurements, etc. So anyhow, we got to the stage where I'm saying to him, how much is all this going to cost, John? He said, yeah, okay, come with me. So we go. And he said, now, what style do you want? And I'd say, well, like a single-breasted. And, yeah, okay, what about the turn-ups? Do you want turn-ups or do you want them plain? No, plain. What size do you want? And he go through all this business, right? And then he come back and say, right, good. John, and he start measuring the other. And then I'm saying to him, how much is all this going to cost? He said, oh, yeah, not a worry, John. He said, not a worry. Now, somewhere here. What I'd like you to do, if you wouldn't mind please, is have a look at this, because you're going to choose the material for me. Right? Just have a look at that, will you? You can't open it up any more than that. It's a piece of material that my suit was made of. Your grandfather was one of the last people to handle that. Okay? Now that is in the collection, unfortunately, here in the library, but it's online very shortly, and Chris will be able to explain to you later on how to get on with that. But I thought you might be interested in that. Okay? Thank you very much, sir. Just take it back to your seat. Thank you. But Kwa, to me, was this tall. He was amazing. And the other day, thanks very much to this gentleman here, he was able to send me a picture that I've been trying to find, Kwa and his shop, Jalapayu. That address is on there as well. 180 to 181 Jalapayu Road, Seletar, Singapore. So there's a lot that I learned, particularly in Jalapayu, believe it or not. Another thing I learned was demand, supply and demand. As you remember, those amongst you that used to go out and buy those oiled paper or oiled skin umbrellas, more like a parasol. Don't see them so much nowadays. You see these modern type things, right? It's always blowing inside out. They were 50 cents when the sun was shining. And a dollar when it was raining. So, I learned a lot about that. If it's in short supply, stick the price up. Okay, now, we got around for 2008. And I'm saying, no, I'm not going back to Singapore because it's far too much changed. Too much is altered. HBOC's gone. No Chong Sams. What's the good of going back to see with no Chong Sams? Come on, girls, please. Reinvent the Chong Sam, will you? Rediscover it. And our younger son said to me, but Dad, what about the food? You've got me. Okay. And he said, I'm sure the people must be nice. Well, I can tell you now, we've been back here now, as Lai explained, etc., these many times, and it certainly is, the people are just as nice as they ever were. Being interviewed on the living room by Pamela and Stanley, they asked me, so what's changed the most since you came here first? The horizon.
Yeah.
Remember? Yeah. What do you mean the horizon? Now I've got 2 30-year-olds sitting in front of me, you know. Young people, I'm thinking, oh, wait a minute, now I'm transgressing into their era, and they don't understand what I'm talking about, so I've got to explain this. Okay, the horizon when I came out here was the height of a palm tree. What do you come out to in the mornings and look at now? Go out to Pongal and go around the Fernvale area and all the rest of it, and look at them lined up along there, you know, they're way up here. So much has changed. And I tell you what, Singapore is just as damn vibrant now as it was then. You've got a few more people around, you've got a lot more properties because you can only either go up or down or a little bit out. I mean, we were around the Britannia Club the other day, and of course that was the seafront. Now you've got all that in front of it, the other side of it. So yes, a lot has changed, but I tell you what, the people are just as damn nice as they ever were. The food sticks just as good. And the other thing I can't, and if anybody's against alcohol, then this is not alcohol I'm going to talk about, this is medication. I can assure you it's medication, and I'll tell you why in a moment. But Tiger beer is like mother's milk. And I actually, with my current doctor, who's a bit radical, and he was telling me about what he wanted me to do, to change my diet a bit and do this. And I said, I suppose the next thing you're going to tell me, well, he said to me, I want you to drink 3 to 5 litres of water a day. I said, that's boring. I want you to drink 3 to 5 litres of water a day. I suppose you're going to tell me next that I can't have a beer at the weekends. And he stopped and he thought and he said, is it liquid? And I said, yes. He said, okay, moderation. So it's medication, right? So the next time you're deciding to have a beer, it's medication. It's in moderation. Yes, there's no Chong Sams, there's no Happy World, no Great World, no jogging dancing, no taxi dancing. The reason we used to go down to the world was there was a few attractions down there, but one of the reasons was you could go down there, you could have a drink, you could also watch the jogging dance and the taxi dancers, and I was amazed at least at the way that they could, you know, I don't dance. You saw me dancing, you'd fall over laughing. But the way that a man and woman could dance in unison without actually touching one another and so forth, sometimes you thought, I don't know, I wouldn't want to touch them in any case, but anyhow. There's no, and the Chinese opera, I used to love going there, they used to have these little boutique Chinese operas, which would be in a room about this size, sort of thing, you know, you'd sit up there, and I used to sit there with a tiger and listen to them, and it just amazed me. I just felt totally and utterly at home, in a sense. So H Block was my home for 3 years. West Camp was my home also, but 81 Squadron was my family. And I'm very, very pleased today that we've got members that carried on that good spirit. They tell me that camaraderie carried on just the same after my time. And even today, oh, here's a little story for you. Game with Pamela. Stanley interrupted and said, oh, well, there's somebody's just phoned in. Oh, yeah, yeah. He said he'd like to talk to you. Is that all right? I said, does the Pope wear funny clothes? Of course it's all right. Talk to anybody. So on the phone came, hello, chap. It was Eddie. And after we'd had a chat on the phone, Pamela and Stanley said, I don't believe it that you've come all this way and you know this bloke. I've never spoken to him before. But you spoke to him as though you knew him. I said, he's an 81er. He's a mate. You can't turn people away like that. He's the salt of the earth. And Hattie. Singapore is, you haven't got many resources in a sense, apart from your very, very high standard of education and your people. So tourism must be extremely important to you. Well, one thing I would ask you to do, if anybody here has got any power to give Tourism Singapore a bit of a kick in the bum, tell them to go out there and stop doing what they're doing and change around a little bit and start to develop a program that can be aired on TV that shows all of the different facets of Singapore, as opposed to relying upon people going into the travel agent in Australia, because we hardly hear anything about Singapore in Australia, and saying, oh, I want to go on holiday. Where do you want to go? Oh, Far East, okay, Bali, Vietnam, Thailand. They'll very rarely talk about Singapore. Now, Singapore has a lot of attractions and it needs putting into a package presented by the Singapore Tourism so that it can be out there in front of people. You can then promote it to the different channels in Australia and throughout the world. You can change it for different areas of the world, etc. So change the language if you're in a language in a country that doesn't speak English. But present it so that they say, ah, I want to go in there. That Singapore, what did I put it down here? A change from the mundane or something like that. But make it a quick clicking name sort of thing. So that when they go in there, they haven't got to start thinking about, oh, what is it? It rolls off the end of the tongue. They go into the travel agent and they say, I'm interested in that program. Now the travel agent is being told, hey, it's Singapore. It ain't Bali, it ain't Vietnam, it ain't Thailand, it ain't anywhere else. It is Singapore. Not everybody wants casinos. There are people that want to do these heritage trips or they have a particular reason. Somebody might, you never know, there might be enough people to say we're going to do a tour of, or we're going to do these lectures on Chinese hieroglyphics or well, whatever. It may not produce hundreds of millions of people coming here, but it's something that may be of interest, I don't know. But anyhow, it needs thinking out. Okay, now, what I'm now going to do is ask if E. Hoon, please, would come up.
you.
Sorry? Pamela. Thank you. Thank you for volunteering. Don't mind you. Yeah. Now, Pamela. I'm going to ask you in a moment to do something for me, or for us, right? First of all, I'd just like to explain, come in here, Pamela, please. Again, I don't want to embarrass Pamela, but she did get me on the block as well, you see, so I didn't know what was going to go on, but she was brilliant. Her understanding was so professional, it was incredible. So, one of the things that we do in Australia and in other parts of the world as well, is at the end of any ceremony or any service, we normally have what we call the opening. Think about those people that gave the ultimate sacrifice. Maybe some of them were your relatives and you were under the occupation. They fought hard as civilians or in the forces. There was a lot of people that weren't Singaporeans, but there was a hell of a lot of Singaporeans as well. So think about those mainland-born Chinese that were taken to Changi Beach, machine gun. Think about the Australian prisoners of war that were marched out of Changi to go and dig holes and bury them because they washed back in the next morning. So all I'm asking you to do is please just cleanse your mind for a moment, and I'm going to ask Pamela, if she wouldn't mind please, after about a minute of silence, if you wouldn't mind just reading this out for us please. I'll give you a moment to read it so you can see how to, Now, if anybody would like to take part in this, can I ask you please just to stand, if you wouldn't mind? Now, if you'll open your wallets, please. Yeah. Okay. Now, I can ask you now just for a moment's silence, please, and then Pamela will take over.
These shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them, lest we forget.
Oh, you're going to put up that thing about the about Ted's book. Up there, good. All right. Now, while that's up on the screen, I've got one little ceremony I'd just like to do at this stage, and if I could ask, please, Eric Chin, if you wouldn't mind, please coming up. And also, Chris, if you wouldn't mind coming up, please, as well. I'm probably jumping the guns a little bit, but Lai and I think we've got this pretty well wrapped up now. We've had a chat with Chris here, and we've had a chat with Afida, and on her behalf, you're here today. This is the only copy that I have. I brought four copies over with me. I'm now going to ask if you two gentlemen please would take possession of this on behalf of the library and of the archives, or the archives and the library, whichever way, don't fight over it, please. But there you go, gentlemen, if you'd like to take that, right? Anybody wants to take a picture of these two gentlemen taking this over, please do so. Thank you. now yours. So if you can't pull it up very shortly on throughout the library and the archives, etc., because I've got the promise that these two won't have fun fights about who owns it. Singapore owns it, right? And it's in the care of the library and the archives. Okay, now I think that's all, apart from one other little thing that I've forgotten about. Has anybody ever seen one of these? You would know if you'd seen one. It's a safe conduct pass. And probably Lying could explain it a little bit better to you because there's various languages that I don't understand. Would you like to just come up for a moment, Mark? And if you want to have a look at it at least, but please be very, very gentle with it. Now you disclosed something about one of
the opposite side. Just reads safe conduct pass. Treat bearer well, give food and medical attention, report to military or police officer. That's very usual, normal. On the reverse, it's all in Chinese, it's different. They have four languages, English, Chinese, Malay written in two scripts, Roman script and the Jawi and Tamil, as what we have now, four languages. But on the reverse, that's interesting. It's all in Chinese, and of all the threats that threaten the communist terrorists, the last sentence reads, I'm going to read in Chinese first. 王死山中会有葬身之地吗? So if you die in the mountains, would you have a proper place to be buried? Fame, money, wealth, everything, they threaten them with this. You die without a proper burial place. So it's quite interesting that we are studying this Bukit Brown Cemetery burial, using 81 Squadron's photograph to look at graves and so on. And then this pass was dropped by the 81 Squadron. Dropped by the RAF, yeah, over Malaya. And they are threatening them with death without proper burial place. One of the most serious things that you can get as a Chinese. You cannot get a proper place to bury. Yeah, that's the significance of this conduct pass. It's not the opposite side, it's the reverse side that's interesting. Yeah, of various factors. You are losing the support of the population because, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 reasons, but the last one is this last line here. Yeah.
So, there you go. Now, these were dropped by communications aircraft. They've been dropped in the thousands over the jungle, over Singapore and so forth. And I had one of those, and that's in the memorabilia that I had it back, because it was no good me taking it back to Australia. It was about Singapore, it's yours. I've given it back to Singapore, and I'm happy to do that. Right, that's the end of me. Now, if anybody's going to go to Changi or to Cranji, if they want to take a poppy, please, 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 if you've never been to Cranji, please go. You don't have to go to Cranji only on the 11th at 11. You can go any time, as we do, and you can have your moment. And I can think about my mates. So please, don't forget the sacrifice, particularly for those people that don't have the benefits of a grave or some sort of recognition. Thank you very much.